Hallelujah. Lift your hand to heaven and glorify God this morning from the depth of your heart. Give him glory, give him honor, give him adoration, celebrate him from the depth of your heart. He's worthy of praise, he's worthy of glory, he's worthy of honor, he's worthy of adoration. Father, we say thank you, we bless your name. Are you thanking God this morning? Do it from the depth of your heart. Give him the glory due unto his name. Father, we say thank you. We bless your holy name. We begin to ask him to speak to you this morning. Lord, I've come for an encounter with you. Speak directly to me by your word today in the name of Jesus. Speak directly to me by your word in the name of Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. And blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' precious name, we have given thanks. Our Father, we thank you for the blessing of seeing this first Sunday in this great month of August. We give you all the praise for all that you have done in the first 7 months of this year. And here we are, Lord, set for another encounter. You have called this our prophetic service. Give each one, O Lord, a supernatural package. Let each one depart here with a turnaround testimony in the name of the Lord Jesus. Let each one of our hearts be open, Lord, to receive your word. Let your word come with clarity and give each one here today an encounter. We give you the praise and glory. In Jesus' precious name we have prayed. Somebody believe, say a loud amen. Amen. Give Jesus a big, big hand of praise. And please, you may be seated in his presence. It is my year of breaking limits. In our Sunday services for this month, we shall be looking at this subject in our teaching series, Understanding How God Leads. Remember from the prophetic focus that was read to us, the theme for this month is, I am a child of destiny. Can we say that together? I am a child of destiny. And that destiny will be made evident in the name of Jesus. Now, according to scriptures, there are no ceilings on our destiny as believers. The Bible makes clear to us in the book of Habakkuk chapter 2, beginning from verse 1, I will stand upon the watch and sit on the tower and see what he will say unto me and what I will answer when I'm reproved. And he will say, write the vision, make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it. The vision is for an appointed time. He said, it will sure, it will, at the end it will speak, it will not tarry, it will surely come to pass. In Mark chapter 9 and verse 23, we are told of the potency of that vision when Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. So there is no limit on the possibilities available to anyone that is a child of God. In fact, according to scripture, every child of God possesses a greater potential in redemption than all of the Old Testament saints. In Matthew chapter 11 and verse 11, Jesus speaking there said, among them that are born of women, there is none that has risen greater than John, notwithstanding. He that is the least in the kingdom is greater than he. So according to Christ, everyone that is in the kingdom carries greater potential than all of those that are listed in the Old Testament. Furthermore, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 39 and verse 40, the Bible puts it this way, concerning all the great heroes of faith, it says, and these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. He said, why? God, having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. What is God saying? Whatever looks like a record is said to be broken. He has ordained each one of us to be pace setters. He has ordained us to be limit breakers. And I see that becoming somebody's experience in the name of Jesus. Amen. Somebody believe it, say a loud amen. Amen. But according to scripture, we can only move from one phase to the other by following the leading of the Holy Spirit. The Bible makes clear in the book of John 14 and verse 12, Jesus speaking there, he said, the works that I do shall you do also, and greater works than these shall you do, because I go to my Father. But in doing these greater works, must recognize that it will be according to the direction of the Spirit of God. In Romans chapter 8, verse 14, it said, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the ones that will manifest their sonship. So our ability to manifest our potential is at the mercy of our access to divine direction. In 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18, it said, we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So the Spirit of the Lord guiding us is what causes us to experience change of level from glory to glory, from level to level. Let me say this morning. According to scriptures, no man has capacity to lead himself. Jeremiah chapter 10 and verse 23. The Bible tells us this. It says, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in him. He said, it is not in a man that walketh to direct his steps. It's vital for us to understand that this leading of an individual's life can only be entrusted in the Holy Spirit. And why is that so? According to Proverbs 14 and verse 12, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. It takes the guidance of the Holy Spirit to pick the path that will end in life. And that is why maximizing one's destiny is absolutely dependent on the leading of the Spirit. Maximizing one's destiny is absolutely dependent on the leading of the Spirit. As we went through the prophetic theme today, we saw a number of vital descriptions concerning the destiny of the redeemed. And we'll just highlight a few of them quickly here by way of reminder. According to scripture, we have all been called to a glorious destiny. Romans chapter 8, verse 29 and verse 30. It said, for whom he did foreknow, them he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. He said, moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. In 2 Peter 1 verse 3, we are told there very clearly that they were being called unto glory and virtue. So every redeemed child of God has a glorious destiny. So may I have a glorious destiny. Secondly, according to scriptures, we have an enviable destiny in Christ. And that is after the order of Isaac in scriptures. The Bible makes clear to us in the book of Genesis 26, verse 12 down to verse 14, how Isaac sowed in the land. He received in the same year and hundredfold. The Lord blessed him. He said he waxed great, went forward and grew until he became very great. And the conclusion of the matter was that the Philistines envied him. They envied him. So we have an enviable destiny, not a pitiable one in redemption. And the Bible is clear that you and I, as Isaac, are also called children of the promise. Galatians 4 and verse 28. So according to scripture, you and I have an enviable destiny in Christ. So may I have an enviable destiny in Christ. Furthermore, we are made to see from scriptures that we have a royal destiny in Christ. You are royalty in Christ. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So according to scripture, every one child of God is royalty by destiny.
Amen.
Revelation 5:10, it says that we are kings and priests ordained to reign upon the earth. That's right here on the earth.
Yes.
So every one child of God is ordained by God to be royalty.
Yes.
And I see that becoming your experience in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We also see that we have a prosperous destiny in Christ. We have a prosperous destiny in Christ. Revelation 5 verse 12, among the heritage of the redeemed, we are made to see there. It said, what is the Lamb who was slain to receive for us power and what? And riches. Every child of God is ordained to operate in prosperity. Amen. Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. He said, if he spared not his own son, but delivered him for us all, how shall he not also with him give us all things? So all things are available for you and for me by reason of redemption. That is the destiny of the redeemed. And I see that becoming your experience. Beyond that, we have a mountaintop destiny in Christ. You are not one that is a candidate for the valley. You are ordained for the mountaintop. Matthew chapter 5. Verse 14, all the way down to verse 16. You are the light of the world. You are a city set upon a hill that cannot be hid. He said, no man lights a candle and puts it under a bushel. You are not to be under, but to be over. Yes. He said, but on a candlestick that it giveth light unto all that are in the house. He said, let your light therefore so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Amen. I see that becoming somebody's experience here. Amen. Furthermore, we have a pace-setting destiny in Christ. Yes. A pace-setting destiny. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 9, it says, I had not seen, ear had not heard, it had not entered into the heart of man the things which God had prepared for them that love him. So everyone that is a child of God is ordained to set the pace. Yes, sir. We are ordained to blaze the trail. That is the ordination. That is the destination of every one redeemed child of God. And these prophetic pictures will become reality in your own life. Amen. Somebody believe it, say loud amen. Amen. And all of this, it goes to show us that every child of God is ordained as a spiritual eagle. We are set to take flight. But an eagle depends absolutely on the wind. It flies upon the wing of the wind. That is why you discover that eagles don't flap their wings to fly. They may flap to take off, but once they find the wind, then you see the eagle just spread its wings. And what is carrying the eagle at that point is the wind. No struggle. You don't see the sweat of an eagle. You only see the flight of the eagle. Nobody will see your sweat again. In the name of Jesus Christ. And that is where our subjection to the leading of the Spirit becomes absolutely vital if we are going to experience the fulfillment of the, you know, prophetic picture that God has shown us concerning our destiny. So destiny, therefore, is absolutely at the mercy of our ability to be led by the Spirit of God. The moment you are led, you will scale heights in life. I see that becoming somebody's experience. So quickly, how do you access divine guidance? How do you access divine guidance? How can you and I gain access to the guidance of the Spirit, which is vital for the fulfillment of our destiny? Number one is be born again. Salvation is the foundation for anyone that seeks to access divine direction. It is the foundation. The Bible says in John chapter 3 and verse 6, it says there that whatsoever is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. There is no way for the Spirit to communicate to the flesh. The Spirit communicates with the Spirit. It means, therefore, that until an individual is born of the Spirit, he cannot be in communication with the Spirit of God. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says there that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. He has been brought into a new category of being. He has left the human realm and has entered into God's realm. That individual becomes a child of God. The Bible says in John chapter 1 and verse 12, it says, for as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that call, that believe upon his name. So everyone that becomes born again becomes a child of God. And it takes a man to communicate with a man. It is individuals or entities that are within the same class of existence that can communicate together. Praise God. Within the same class of existence that can communicate together. If you are going to communicate effectively with God, you must be in his class. And that class can only be attained via salvation. Until a man is born again, he is not in the class of God. And therefore, it becomes impossible for that individual to have effective access to the communications of heaven. Like God's servant, our father said before, you can have your dog very well trained, very obedient, very well, you know, astute, and put the dog there and say, be watching the news for me. And when the news finishes, report to me what happens. When you come back and ask the dog what happened, the dog will bark at you. Because all that he saw, is there is none that he understood. All that he heard, there was none that he could access. Because he's not in the same class. He's not in the same class or category of existence. Therefore, there is no way to have effective communication. In the same vein, anyone who is not in Christ cannot have effective communication with God. It's absolutely impossible. Because he is not in the category and class of being that allows him to gain access to the direction of God. The Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 32, beginning from verse 9 down to verse 14, it tells us there, it said, the Lord's portion is his people. So it's not talking about everybody here. It's talking about his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. They belong to him. It said that he found him in a desert land, in a waste howling wilderness. He led him about. Not that there were no other people there, but just this one. He led him about and instructed him. These words are highly personal words. He kept him as the apple of his eye. He said, he, as an eagle stirred up her nest and fluttered her young and spread abroad her wing and taketh them and buried them on her wings. He said, so the Lord alone did lead him. He said, and there was no strange God with him. All of them are personal words. So he says, he made him to ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase of the field. Then he made him to suck honey out of the rock and oil out of the flinty rock. Hallelujah. All of these pictures go to show us that when it comes to our access, it is personal on the basis of our own salvation. Until an individual gains access to salvation and becomes born again, he can't access the leading of the Spirit of God. He can't. Everything will be guesswork. He can't pick the signals of God. He can't pick the directives of God. He led him. He led him. He led him. He led him. He took him. He guided him. All of them, him. Just this individual that was the Lord's portion, the one that was the Lord's inheritance, those that belong to him. So until an individual is born again, he cannot gain access to the direction of the Spirit of God. Romans chapter 8 and verse 14, it said, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. So if you see anyone who is being led by God, that individual, first of all, must have been a son of God. It takes salvation as a foundation for anyone to be guided and to be led by the Spirit of God. That is why, if there's anyone who is connected today, who is yet to be saved, don't be asking for direction first. Ask for salvation first. It is salvation that qualifies you to gain access to his direction. So open your heart up and receive the one who will guide you. And that is the only way for you to begin to enjoy divine guidance. You will not miss it in Jesus' name. Amen. Number two is be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in the book of John chapter 16, verse 12, all the way down to verse 15, he said, I have many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He said, he shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and show it unto you. This is Jesus speaking here. He said, there are many things I want to say to you, but there is no way you can handle it now. You don't have the capacity to discern what it is that I am saying. As a result of that, I will wait until the Spirit of Truth comes. Because when he arrives upon your life, then he will guide you into all truth. You see, it takes the baptism of the Spirit of God for any individual to be able to gain access to the directions of God. And why is that so? Because the Holy Spirit empowers our spirit man to receive the directions of God. Empowers our spirit man to receive the directions of God. Romans chapter 8 and verse 16. The Bible makes us to understand here. It said the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirits. It connects to our spirit man and makes us to see and hear the things that God is saying. So it takes this outpouring of the Spirit of God upon our lives for us to begin to experience the directions of God. I was studying and I discovered something in the book of Matthew chapter 3. The Bible said there, verse 16 and verse 17, it says there, after Jesus was baptized, he said, when he was baptized and went up straightway out of the water, lo, the heavens were open. And the Spirit of God, descending like a dove, lighted upon him, landed on him, and a voice came from heaven. As soon as the Spirit came, the voice followed. He says, saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And then the next verse, which is chapter 4 and verse 1. And the Spirit led him into the wilderness. As soon as the Spirit came, guidance followed. So it takes the outpouring of the Spirit to gain access to the guidance of God. You want to be guided by God. God is saying first, be filled with the Spirit. 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 The entire early church was kept captive, as it were, in the upper room until the Holy Ghost came. And when the Holy Ghost came, suddenly you began to hear the voice of the Spirit speaking through men. These individuals were absolutely guided by God step by step as soon as the outpouring of the Spirit came. That is why if you are yet to be baptized with the Holy Ghost, you must position yourself in this season. And say, no, because it's a free gift given to you and to me. He said, repent and be baptized and you shall receive the gift. So it's available for you and for me. There is no price to pay. Jesus paid the price. All you need to do is to look up to the baptizer himself. He said he's the one who will pour out that gift to you and to me. John said in the book of Matthew chapter 3, and verse 11 and verse 12, he said, I baptize you with water to repentance, but he that comes after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. So Jesus is the baptizer.
Yes, sir.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is the baptizer. He is the baptizer. So you can look unto him right now, and you can connect with the Holy Spirit. As you, Lord, Holy Spirit, Lord, I see now, Jesus, you are the baptizer. And call on him and ask him to pour out the Spirit upon you. And he will cause you to begin to speak as the Spirit gives utterance. You discover in the scripture that in the book of Acts chapter 2, nobody laid hand on all of those people to be baptized with the Spirit. The Bible said they were praying. And when the day of Pentecost was come, he said suddenly. So it doesn't happen, it doesn't take time. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven. And as the result of that, every one of them were filled with the Spirit and began to speak with tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The only authentic evidence of being baptized with the Holy Ghost is speaking in tongues. Speaking in tongues. Don't say I'm filled, but I can't speak. No. Speaking in tongues is the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's the evidence. Is the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I say shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's the gauge. That's the way you know that the Spirit of God has already baptized you. That's the gauge. You don't go to a fuel station and buy fuel and you're looking at the gauge. The man put something inside your tank and you're looking at the gauge. The gauge still the same. I say, has filled your tank. You say, no. The evidence that this tank is full is that the gauge has moved. until you speak in tongues, there's no evidence that you are filled with the Spirit of God. The evidence of the baptism with the Spirit of God is the fact that you are speaking in tongues. And I see everyone who is yet to have received that experience receiving it today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Somebody believe it, say louder, amen. Amen. I said somebody believe it, say louder, amen. Amen. Now, number three is be clothed with meekness. Be clothed with meekness. In the book of Psalm chapter 25 and verse 9, the Bible says, the meek will he guide in judgment, and the meek will he teach his way. Meekness is a fundamental requirement for divine guidance. If you are going to be guided by God, you must be certified as meek by God. Jesus put it this way in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 and verse 29. He said, come unto me, all of you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come and take my yoke upon me and learn of me, for I am meek and I am lowly in heart. Without meekness, you cannot gain access to divine guidance. The Bible says in James chapter 4, verse 6, it says, wherefore it says, he gives more grace, wherefore God resisted the proud and giveth more grace to the humble. So the grace to pick direction is given towards the humble. If you want to therefore learn to pick instructions and direction from God, then you must subject yourself to meekness. An individual that lacks meekness will automatically lack guidance. And why is that so? In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6 and verse 7. It says there, in verse 5 and verse 6, sorry. It says there, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Look at that. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. The word understanding is beyond knowledge. It talks about knowledge that has been processed. So understanding is usually a depiction of wisdom. When you see a man of wisdom, it's a man that usually has understanding. But here the Bible says, even when you have understanding, don't lean on it. For you to be guided by God, you must understand the fact that even your own understanding must be neglected at his direction. God's servant has told us over and again how that when he was being brought to Canaan land here from the church in Rajoba, and the journey continued and continued and continued, he began to ask, where do you think we are going? It's church we are talking about. We are not talking about famine. You can't be going out of town. Out of town, those days there was nothing literally in this area. And living where people are. Going to where people are not. But as soon as he got here, he said, suddenly the Spirit of God said, this is the place. It takes meekness to submit your understanding to his direction. Because a man of meekness is a man that is swift to correction. Swift. The moment you are agitating against correction, you are demonstrating absence of meekness. Swiftness to correction is what you refer to as weakness, meekness. That's why if you look at that scripture we saw earlier in Psalm 25 and verse 9, it said, the meek will he guide in judgment. The meek will he teach his way. Because the meek can be corrected. He can think it should be this way, and God said it's that way, and he submits his own understanding to God's direction. That's meekness. And that is the only way for you to continuously gain access to divine guidance. We must demonstrate practical meekness. No wonder we are told in scripture that the meek will inherit the earth. Because they are directed by God, they can't miss their portion on the earth. So it's important for us to understand that you and I have a responsibility to stoop down in meekness in order to allow God to guide us. To stoop down in meekness in order to allow God to guide us. We must stoop down in meekness. Look at what God has made today in Canaan land. By accepting that one correction, this is the place. It may not look like it, but this is the place. I saw something in the book of Matthew chapter 3 early this morning. The Bible said there in verse 1 concerning John. It says there, in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. It's a statement that does not seem to make sense. John came, and where should John preach? He went to the wilderness of Judea. Look at verse 2. It says there, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I'm wondering who is in the wilderness that he's talking to. But here is what the Bible says. Look at verse 3. It says there, for this is what was spoken of Isaiah. That is the direction that he has. That there is a voice of one that will be crying in the wilderness. It won't be in the city. It's in the wilderness. Prepare ye the way of the Lord and make straight paths. Make his path straight. And look at what it says next. Look at verse 4. And the same John had his raiment, he said, of camel's hair and so forth. And verse 5 tells us this concerning John. He says, and then went out. The people were not where he was speaking. He was inside the wilderness. The people were in the city. But went out to him. What went out to him? Did he say people? Not people. Jerusalem. Judea. And all the regions round about. Not people now. The entire city was coming out to meet him. Why? Because God led him. Where God leads you to may look dry to the natural eyes, but if it is his guidance, it will always lead into plenty. It may look dry. The wilderness is not where anyone will expect anything that will flourish to take place. But right there in the wilderness, the Bible says all Jerusalem came, all of Judea, and all the region round about. It didn't say many people. It said Jerusalem. Jerusalem came as a contingent. Judea as a contingent. Then all the region about, they also came as their contingent, including the Pharisees, Sadducees. That even when John saw them, he said, what are you doing here? Who is it that warned you? Which means it's not even the one who warned them. Who is it that warned you of the rod that is to come? These individuals were coming to meet him in the wilderness because God led him there. People are busy looking for greener pasture to run to, thinking that it is a change of location that will bring a change of situation. It is God's guidance that makes a difference. It is God's guidance that makes the difference. It is God's guidance that makes the difference. It is God's guidance that makes the difference. Shout hallelujah. I say shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I say shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So don't just carry your bag one day and say, I'm running to this place. I'm running to that place. Yeah, I'm going to Germany. I'm going to UK. I'm going to US. You can go to Germany and jam neat. Everything just lock up one time. Because if God did not lead you, then you find out that what you think is a greener pasture is actually plastic grass. You will find yourself starving without anything to show. Because it is not God guiding you. But when God leads you, the Bible says they tested not when he led them. He led them into the wilderness. He caused the rock to cause water to flow out for them. He cleaved the rock and the waters gushed out because he was the one leading them. My prayer is that each one of us today will develop the meekness required to follow divine guidance. Somebody believe it, say loud amen. I say I pray that each one of us will develop the meekness required to follow divine guidance in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Number 4 is through the voice of the Spirit. Through the voice of the Spirit. Through the voice of the Spirit. In John chapter 10, verse 4 and verse 5, the Bible tells us this, and when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him. Why? For they know his voice. It says, and a stranger will they not follow. It said, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. Verse 27 of the same scripture. It said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. You see, we see here from scripture that the Spirit of God voices the mind of God. Voices the mind of God. We saw earlier in the book of John chapter 16. Remember when Jesus was speaking there, beginning from verse 13 down to verse 15. Jesus said this, howbeit when the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. And verse 14 tells us, he will glorify me, for he will receive of mine, and he will show it to you. So when we talk about, you know, the voice of God, we're actually talking about the voice of the Spirit of God, because he takes from him and shows it to us. It bears the mind of God, or voices the mind of God in our direction. So we are led or we receive guidance through the voice of the Spirit of God. Now, in the book of Acts chapter 8, we come across Philip from verse 25 to verse 29. The Bible tells us that the Spirit of God spoke and said to Philip, join yourself to that chariot. Join yourself to that chariot. Just clear direction. And you saw Philip's ministry take another turn. After joining that chariot and baptizing the eunuch, the Bible says the Spirit caught him up. He was taken up. And then landed in another city by spiritual flight. The Spirit of God launched him to another dimension just by heeding the voice of the Spirit of God. Now, the Bible is very clear concerning the last days. It said, for in the last days, it said there that the Spirit of God speaks expressly. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, in the last days. So the last days are the days where the voice of the Spirit will be sounding clearly to each one of us. And that's why when you look at the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 7, it said, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Verse 11, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Verse 17, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Verse 29, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Chapter 3, verse 6, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Verse 13, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. And verse 22, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. So the Spirit is continuously saying. But you and I must be continuously picking. So the issue is not whether he is speaking or not, it's whether we are picking or not. And that's why it becomes important for you and I to position ourselves to take delivery of what the Spirit is saying. It's not that the Holy Spirit will say, okay, I don't speak on Mondays, I only speak on Tuesdays. No. He said he's speaking continuously, but you and I have to tune in to be picking continuously. Shout hallelujah. And that is where it becomes important for you and I to recognize that we must adjust ourselves. Now, Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. The Bible says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard. So it takes being in the Spirit to hear. So for you and I to hear, the first requirement is that we must be in the Spirit. We must be in the Spirit. Somebody may say, oh, but it's because it's the Lord's day. No, he said, I was in the Spirit. I was in the Spirit. There's no day that is not God's day. Every day is God's day. But you and I must be in the Spirit for it to be our day. I was in the Spirit and then I heard. So you and I must learn to be in the Spirit. Be in the Spirit. That is a vital requirement for picking that which God has to say to you and to me. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 14. The Bible says there that the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So we must be in the spirit. The natural man will not understand what is going on. Don't you see people who many times will say they are believers? They say, after something has happened, they now say, it's as if something was trying to tell me. They were not sensitive. They couldn't pick it. As if something was trying to tell me, I shouldn't do this or I shouldn't do that, but you have already done it and what wants to happen has happened. But the problem there is absence of the sensitivity of the spirit. So you and I must learn to be in the spirit every single day. Be in the spirit every single day. Be in the spirit. Don't let being in the spirit only be for service day. Be in the spirit every day. Be in the spirit every day. At every point in time. Number two is you must walk in the spirit. And this is very important. Walk in the spirit. The Bible says in the book of Galatians chapter 5 and verse 25. It says, if we live in the spirit, let us also walk in the spirit. That means it is not just something that is a section of your day. Everything you are doing, you are walking in the spirit. Hallelujah. You are walking in the spirit. Because what he wants to say does not need to wait for your prayer time. It can come at any time. So you must walk in the spirit. We have been told that the direction that brought about the movement of this commission to Lagos, how did they come? God's servant said, was in the shower when the Lord spoke to him and said, now arise, get down to Lagos and raise me a people. He was not in prayer, he was in the shower. But right there, walking in the spirit, pick the signal of the spirit and look at what has become of that singular instruction. You see, the greatest instructions of our life may not necessarily come at the times that we think they should come. They can come at any time. Because someone said he was driving in the car, coming back tired, you know, driving, and hungry in the car. He said, and right there, the voice of the Spirit came again. The harvest of Africa is now overripe. Rushing to preserve it from decadence. Rushing. So there are instructions that will come at very odd times. At very odd times. And you and I must learn to operate in a way that we are walking in the spirit no matter what it is that we are doing. You are right there on your table walking, doing some things. Make sure you are operating in the spirit. Connected to the realm of the spirit. You are driving, connected to the spirit at every point in time. It says walk in the spirit. Walk in the spirit. That is the key for you and I to keep picking the signals of the spirit. Don't forget, the spirit of God is never tired of speaking. But you and I must never be tired of picking. Must never be tired of picking. My prayer is that for each one of us, the grace, not only to be in the spirit, but to walk in the spirit, will come afresh upon each one of us. Amen. Somebody believe it, say loud, amen. Amen. I said, I pray that that grace will come afresh upon each one of us. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, let's look at the biblical proofs of being led by the Spirit. What are the proofs? If I'm being led by the Spirit, there should be some clear evidences. We must be able to test and prove that indeed it is the Spirit of God that is guiding us. In 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 20 and verse 21, the Bible tells us there, it said, despise not prophesying. It says, prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. Prove all things. So if I'm being led by the Spirit, there should be some proof, some evidences, some things that will be clear to show that that leading is from God. So let's take two of them this morning. Number one is peace that passes all understanding. Peace. When you are led by God, one of the evidences is peace. Psalm 85 and verse 8. It says, I will hear what the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly. I will hear what the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people. You see, God's leading is always in the direction of peace. Look at what the Bible says in Psalm 23. We're ready for our call to worship. It said that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. But what else? He leadeth me beside the still waters. There is always peace around the leading of God. Your heart will always be at peace when God is leading you. When God is directing you, there will always be peace. In Isaiah chapter 48, verse 17 and verse 18, it says, "Thus said the Lord thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teacheth thee to profit, and which leadeth thee by the way that thou shouldest go." And verse 18, "Oh, that thou wouldest hearken to my commandments, follow my leadings." He said, "Then had thy peace been as a river." So God makes it clear that if you are following his direction, there should be peace. You can't be having agitation inside of your heart and claiming that it is God directing you. It is a proof that you are missing it somewhere. There must be peace and serenity when you are being guided and led by God. You know, the truth is that when God is leading an individual, even if there's turbulence around them, inside them there's peace. When you see turbulence everywhere, but inside them you see calmness, serenity. It's just as if these individuals are outside of the things troubling others. When Jesus was in the boat, all the other men, you know what they said to Jesus when the storm came? They said, "Master, carest not that we perish." They have died as far as they are concerned. And all they're asking, are you not concerned that all of us are dying now? And Jesus rebuked the wind.
Yes.
Why? Because inside of him, the Bible says he was asleep inside the storm. Peace. Hallelujah. Why? Because everywhere Jesus went, he went there by direction.
Yes. Yes.
And therefore he maintained peace no matter what was going on around him. So the moment inside you there is trouble, agitation, your heart is beating, you are having palpitation, it is not, watch that direction. That God doesn't lead like that. God does not lead like that. When he speaks, he will speak peace. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In Philippians chapter 4 and verse 7, the Bible says, "And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding," he said, "it shall keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." So your heart is kept in peace. Your mind is kept in peace when you are being led by the Lord. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I say shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Number two biblical proof of being led by the Spirit of God is liberty of the Spirit. Liberty of the Spirit. In Acts chapter 20, verse 22 and verse 23, this is Paul the apostle speaking here. "And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there." He says, "Save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me." I go bound in the Spirit. I go bound in the Spirit. And I look at those two verses and I'm not sure what he didn't know. Because he already said there that the Holy Ghost is witnessing that when you arrive there, bonds, which means captivity and affliction, trouble, is waiting for you when you arrive there. But he still went there, and as he was going, he was bound in the Spirit. You see, it's important for us to understand that it takes liberty in the Spirit for anyone to truly be guided by God. It's the same Paul who said in 2 Corinthians 3 verse 17, he said, "Wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." There must be an internal liberty inside of you if it is God that is leading you. You can't be held captive within, bound inside, constrained within. Shout hallelujah. You see, it's important for us to understand that God leads us through our spirit man. So he will constrain your spirit man when you're about missing it. That's why he was talking there about being bound in the Spirit. The Spirit of God was constraining him, saying, "No, don't go." Trying to pull him back. But Paul said, "No, I must go. That Jerusalem, I must get there. No matter what happens, that place, I must arrive in Jerusalem by force." And he arrived there. And what he met there was all kinds of trouble. Why? Because he was not sensitive to the fact that the Spirit of God was constraining him, pulling him back, restraining him. But you see, one thing about God is God will never force you. He will only direct you. God did not command, did not tell us he will force us. He said he will direct us. He will show you the way you should go. If you decide to go another way, he will try to constrain you. But if you keep going, he allows you to go. So Paul, as great an apostle as he was, he ignored that divine constraint and went bound in the spirit. He may have mistaken his determination for direction. And as a result of that, he saw a manner of devastation. Don't ever mistake determination for direction. Don't ever mistake determination for direction. He determined he must go there. In fact, the Bible tells us, he said he must spend Pentecost in Jerusalem. He must get there for it. He determined it. And he was mistaken that determination for direction. And look at what became of him. Well, ultimately, the truth is this. We have access to the guidance of the Spirit of God, but must watch out for these proofs. If he's leading me, I will have peace. And if he's leading me, I will have liberty. Yes. I pray that for each one of us, our eyes will remain open and our ears open and our hearts sensitive to the direction of the Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Lift your hand to heaven and give thanks to God for his word that you have received this morning. Give him glory, give him honor. Father, thank you. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' precious name we have prayed. Before we go any further this morning, if you are here connected to this service from anywhere across the globe and you are not yet born again, that's the starting point. You cannot have this experience of being guided by the Spirit of God until you are a child of God, and that requires salvation. Therefore, if you are not yet born again, this is your opportunity. Also, there are those who have gone astray. You have gone off course. You have lost your sensitivity, therefore, to pick the directives of the Spirit of God. You know that you need to return to God so that you can be restored by God. This is also your opportunity. Anyone in any of those two conditions, lift up your right hand and pray this prayer after me and do so in faith. Say after me, Lord Jesus. Louder, Lord Jesus. I come to you today. I am a sinner. I cannot help myself. But I know you died for me. And on the third day you rose again. Just to save me. Jesus, come into my life as my Lord and Savior. Take control of me from this day forward. I will follow you, no turning back. And I will serve you, no turning back. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep your hand lifted. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you today for each one, O Lord, that has responded to this call. No one ever comes to you that you turn back. Therefore, thank you for accepting them. Lord, let the grace that has drawn them to you keep them walking with you all the days of their lives. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' precious name we have prayed. Somebody believe, say loud, amen. It is done. Please send us the testimony of your salvation. The address is right there on the screen, newbirth@lfcww.org. We want to be part of your joy and keep celebrating God's goodness in your life. Welcome to a new adventure in God, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen and amen. Shall we rise on our feet, everybody, and give Jesus a big hand as we get to receive his blessing.
Give the Lord a big hand of praise in the name of Jesus Christ.